So, Charlie, here we are again. It seems like you and I and others in this town have been talking about transportation funding issues for as long as we can remember. And here we are back again in another off-election year with the governor and the legislature at odds about the nature of and the size of the fix. I think we all agree that transportation, our system needs significant attention. I think we all agree that it is not properly funded. I think the issues of disagreement have been around the scope and the size of the fix and the timing of it. And obviously, I have expressed deep disappointment in the legislative plan that was introduced earlier this week, because it seemed to me that it was significantly below where we need to be, that it significantly departed from where I had, where the governor was, but not just where the governor was, where a lot of thoughtful civic leaders have been, people who were on the 2007 Transportation Finance Commission, for example. And so the debate seems to me really now to be engaged. I've never seen the public and advocates more energized, as I've noticed this week, on the subject of getting the legislature to rethink its commitment to robustly funding our transportation future. So what are your thoughts on it? And let's engage in this little dialogue here.
Yeah, I guess my thoughts on it are, well, first of all, I think you did a good job of sort of laying out what the issue is. There is no doubt that this system is not funded appropriately or enough. I guess where my issue with it is comes down to this. One thing that I have noticed for as long as I've been watching politics in Massachusetts is that every governor, and that's not just this governor, every governor I've ever seen acts as if time started when he put his hand down in the Bible. And to me, this governor's transportation plan is perhaps the most obvious example of that. What is so clear to me as I look at this is that that if you were to try to develop a plan that would get us back where we are today in 20 years, it would be what the governor has proposed. Because what it does is it repeats the cycle of doing a series of things. One, massively expanding the fastest expanding system in the country. Two, lowballing the cost of all that expansion. And third, and most importantly, doing all the expansion without accounting for the cost of operating and maintaining the assets. And that is exactly what got us here. And that is exactly what the governor's plan would do. And I just feel very strongly that, yes, we can disagree about the number. But what I think is the most important thing, if we want to have a system that facilitates economic development, that gets people to work, that is reliable, whatever the number is, every penny of it needs to go into maintaining and bringing up to speed this system that we have that has been in which maintenance and operation costs have been sacrificed for two decades at the altar of more and more and more unsustainable expansion.
Well, let's talk about this. I'm glad you brought expansion up. I don't want to get too distracted by it for this reason. I think we can both agree that there are significant state of good repair needs, and we should talk about those, that include things that are not in the legislative plan, that are not funded by that. State of good repair needs that range from new orange and red line trains. That's, you know, billions of dollars worth of equipment so people can actually get to their destinations without cars stopping in tunnels, without air conditioning malfunctioning in the summer. Signaling systems that are critical to the overall safety of the system. These are not trivial costs, and none of those costs, as I understand the plan that the House and the Senate put out this week, are included in what they're trying to do. But I would say this on expansion. You know, I spoke in front of Conservation Law Foundation when I was the secretary, and I said that I thought the people who didn't appreciate expansion were people who knew the cost of everything and the value of nothing. And by that I mean, yes, of course expansions are costly, But I would argue expanding the Green Line to Tufts University is about as good an example as you can get of how to generate better mobility for the kinds of jobs creators that we take for granted sometimes, like the university systems. Tufts doesn't have that kind of connectivity today. They will when the Green Line is expanded. I'm a big believer, and I think Senator McGee is, in connecting the Blue Line to Lynn. I wasn't a believer until I actually saw it when I was secretary, where you have an underutilized garage facility in downtown Lynn that I think could be full every single day with people who could park their cars there from Lynn and Saugus and Swampscott and come down to Logan to travel or to work or to downtown, or if they ever build Suffolk Downs to have their destination there. I think that expansion is not a bad thing, and I don't think it should be excluded from the mix. In other words, I think we need to pay attention to state of good repair, but I also think we need to grow for the future. If we don't do that, if we let a generation go by or decades go by without targeted strategic expansions, and the two I mentioned I think would be in that category, we're not going to lay a proper foundation for the kind of jobs creation, cleaner air, quality of life that I think the next wave of jobs creators, innovative people, want to have here in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts.
Well,
but let's not forget that expansion is not the only issue. It is state of good repair, and even that is not in this legislative proposal.
Well, a couple things on that. You're going to be surprised because I'm actually going to agree with you on the expanding the Green Line, but for a very different reason probably than what you would say. The fact of the matter is, we have these transit mitigation requirements, I'm sure, you know, that come from 1991 that I'm sure you're aware of. Where we would probably disagree is that I absolutely believe they were the most disastrous transportation decision of the last half of the 20th century, and I believe that they are the single largest cause of the mess we're in today. That being said, we can't do anything about them now. I think that, no pun intended, the train left the station, and I was there. It was when I was in government, and I was desperately trying to get the Romney administration, when I was there, to fight them and not to build Greenbush entirely on the state dime. But when they wouldn't do that fight, you know, if we didn't fight it then we, you know, there's no going back now. You know, what the Conservation Law Foundation has done to us, they've done to us, and we can't undo it at this point. So I would agree with you on extending the Green Line. If we're going to have to build it, I'd rather have the feds pay for part of it than pay for all of it ourselves. You know, a couple other things on that. I think that, you know, you talk about strategic expansion, but then you get to running a train between Pittsfield and Manhattan. I mean, that sort of makes people say, I mean, I know that medical marijuana is legal now, but did I do something I wasn't aware? I mean, this is, you know, this is madness. And the bottom line is, Jim, that in a certain sense, I think that what you say makes sense, except for there's one other thing, and that's that transportation is not the only thing we got to do. And to think that we're going to be able to build all these expansions and then actually come up with money to build them and then come up with money to, maintain and operate them in an environment in which within a very few years there won't be any money left after we're done paying for health care, I just don't understand that.
Well, let me make – you just said something I want to agree with, which is transportation isn't the only thing we have to do, which is why I really feel strongly that – whatever plan comes out this year, if any does, needs to tie transportation revenue to transportation sources. I'm a big supporter, therefore, and I'm very disappointed that it still isn't in anybody's plan, of a pilot VMT plan, a pure user fee. I believe that even though I support it, a significant, as you know, gas tax increase, because I think the value of the current gas tax in real dollars is about 12 cents.
Yeah, agreed.
I think we need a substantial gas tax increase. I've supported this year a 20 cent increase. But I'm a realist. I'm a big believer in new energy vehicles. I don't believe that our future lies in fossil fuels. And I think increasingly as cars become more fuel efficient or more hybrid oriented, the power of the gas tax will increasingly diminish. We need to move into a more technology oriented revenue generation approach, which is why I've supported VMT as a pure user fee. So my point is, I think that whenever we raise revenues from taxes or fees, yes, there are lots of other needs that the Commonwealth has, education, public safety and security, healthcare, which is why from the transportation perspective, we kind of need, I think, to suck it up and say the money needs to come from transportation sources. Right now, the best source is a robust gas tax. Tomorrow, I think the best source will be fair and robust user fees, and we need to set the stage for that. We're not doing any of this under the plans that I've seen, and I think we're squandering an opportunity to be a leader. We are, you know, this is still the home of MIT and Harvard and Tufts and BC and BU. We've got a creative class of young people who are tomorrow's job creators. They're not going to stay in Boston or this region because the weather is better than San Francisco. They're going to stay here because the quality of life is better. And we better get the quality of life right. One way to do it is to improve our mobility system. And I believe that means a real focus on the T and a real focus on improving the way we generate revenue.
I couldn't agree with you more about VMT. Absolutely the way we have to go. I could not agree more. I guess my one like little sort of grassy knoll conspiracy theory is that what is looming in terms of healthcare costs and things like that that are exploding, and you know the people who are paying attention know what's coming in the next year or two. I think that has a lot to do with why the governor's plan is not from transportation sources and from the income tax, because I think he knows that much of it's going to need to be moved to plug other holes. So that's my theory on it. I agree it should come as much as possible from transportation sources. And the clock is telling me we got to finish. Do you have any last things you want to add?
I thought this was a very interesting discussion because it seemed to me that people will be surprised that I think we've agreed more than we've disagreed. I'd like to put out a challenge to anybody who wants to reach out to me and join me one day on the T, take the 28 bus, take one of the Silver Line buses, go to East Boston and try to get in and out of Logan on the T. I think that I'm going to guess that most people in the legislature who are putting out this underfunded plan haven't seen the inside of a bus in a long, long time. I'm happy to join them and show them around, and I'm sure some of the advocates are, and maybe people will take me up on that.
I'd agree with you on that, too.
All right, you and I can do it together, Charlie.
That's right. I'm on it all the time. I agree.
Okay. All right. Let's think about that, and thank you for the conversation.
Thank you.